So we are very fortunate tonight, and this was the original purpose of the program, but things have changed. History changes within a few days, and so we transformed the program. So Muriel Fanon-Mendes-France is here from France. She's a longtime supporter of Mumia. For those who don't know, she was involved in the street naming of Rue Mumia Abu-Jamal in Saint-Denis way back, 10 years ago. And she's done many, many wonderful things over the years in that capacity. But recently, I guess about 10 years ago, maybe 15, she founded the Frantz Fanon Foundation, of course named after her father. And she's the head of the Fanon Foundation, which has a website and puts out a lot of information. And then 5 years ago, she was chosen to be on a UN-sponsored council called the Workshop on People of African Descent. And this is in the decade of people of African descent declared internationally. And this workshop has lasted for 5 years. She chaired it. Five people were on this body. And they put out an amazing report, which is really, I was kind of not paying attention for a while. And then I read the report. I said, we gotta have Muriel speak. So I'm very happy to welcome Muriel, but we're not ready to have you speak yet. And then afterwards, things changed so quickly. As you know, about 10 days ago, we found out that Judge Mariani, who looked so kindly and reasonable in the courtroom, and people said, oh, look, he looks so impressed. He's impressed by the doctor, our doctor, he's impressed by our lawyers. And as we walked out, Ramona said, you know, I've seen this before. He ain't gonna do shit. And Mona is a visionary, not just because of that, but we've seen over the years that Mona is a visionary. So she turned out to be absolutely right. And as you know, this report was absolutely ridiculous because it gave all the reasons. Folks in the back, please keep your voices down or go to the back. As we know, for those of you who don't know, he justified the lawyer's arguments and said that they were absolutely right, that the practice of the Department of Corrections violated the U.S. Constitution, in particular this Eighth Amendment of cruel and unusual punishment, but they filed with the wrong person. They charged the wrong person with the crime, and who he mentioned hadn't even existed at the time when they filed the papers. Not only that, but when we were in the courtroom, those of you who were there remember, nobody ever said, hey, you're filing with the wrong person. And they never told him after the fact. So you know what this is about. It's a lot of bullshit to cover his ass and to not have to go against the system and to do the cowardly thing, even though intellectually he knew better, because his arguments totally substantiate our position. So we decided, of course, to have Pam Africa come and talk about that. And she will be leading that discussion. And then we have Rachel Wolkenstein talking about a very exciting development. Again, for those who don't know, Rachel was one of Mumia's lawyers back with Len Wineglass a long time ago. And she has never stopped working for Mumia, continues to visit him and so on and so on, and is a lawyer on many of the prisoners in Pennsylvania in particular. Some amazing work she's done. I won't take time to go into it, but you can ask her some. Some people who are close to Mumia that she's helped legally, and she does a lot of very important legal work. But tonight she's going to be talking about, and check this out, everybody. You know, we're not just after Mumia's getting hepatitis C treatment, right?
Right.
What are we after?
Everybody.
Okay, so for the first time in a long time, something has come up in the courts that literally opens up the, if there was even an ounce of justice in this system, and Pam is saying there is none, so, but if there were, this issue would open up Mumia's case and could not only get him a new trial, but could get him free, because it exposes the total outrage of how this case went down, and in particular, on the issue of the, who was the Supreme Court Justice of Pennsylvania back in the late 70s. Is it 70s? Yeah. 90s. I've been at this too long. 90s. After the Sabo decision, it went to the Supreme Court eventually. He was head of the Supreme Court. He had also been head of the District Attorney's Office. And so at the time, some of you may remember, I saw Bill Bachman walk in. I thought the coalition at that time, Bill and I, and what was Cleo's husband's name? What is his name?
Ron.
The three of us worked on a petition, which we distributed widely at that time, to get Castile to recuse himself. And guess what? Did he?
No.
Okay, so Rachel's going to talk about that. It's an amazing stuff. She's done great work on it. She's explained the possibilities, and I really look forward to hearing her again. So these are the three speakers. But before we do that, I want to introduce some of our, everybody's notable in this audience, but I want to introduce some people in particular. First of all, Ramona Africa is in our midst. Stand up, Ramona. Our visionary, one of our visionaries. And Ramona always knows how to call it. And she called
proof
it this
is
judge.
In the pudding.
The proof is in the pudding. It turned out to be right. Today is Leonard Peltier's birthday.
Wow!
Free Leonard Peltier! And we have in our midst Maggie. Could you stand up, Maggie? So Maggie is working on the celebration. She has cards for the celebration. Everybody should join and come and celebrate this great elder, particularly as we see what's happening in North Dakota. What could be more positive than support the letter?
And if you haven't filled out a postcard for Clemency, I have those too. Just let me know.
Okay.
Thank you.
And then we have Joe Catron. Where is Joe?
Joe's here.
Please stand up.
Joe, stand up.
Joe, along with many other activists, just won an incredible victory. An incredible victory in Palestine. Listen, everybody. The brother, Bilal Kayed, who was on a hunger strike for days and days and days because of the outrageous practices of the Israeli government of arresting people without trial, without anything, without formal charges, and then renewing after the sentence is up. You know, so you've served your 6 months, you've served your 2 years, whatever, which on bullshit, but there's no charges. Then they say, oh, we can't reveal the reasons, but we have to keep you again. So this time, when this brother was not Joe, but the brother Bilal was kept again, he said, I'm going on a hunger strike. And the rest of the progressive, the People's Liberation Front of Palestine, many of the other prisoners joined him, and there was a big, and Israel made a tremendous concession. Israel has announced that he will be released in December. We all should pay attention, and that the charges will not be renewed. So that was a great victory, and Joe played a major role. And we have all the way from New Jersey, from Newark, New Jersey, a longtime supporter of Mumia, Zaid Muhammad. Could you please stand up?
Yes.
And then there are many, many other people to announce, but I want to acknowledge the campaign to free Mumia is here. Quite a few of you, raise your hands, those of you in the campaign. Yes, please stand up so people see you. Okay? I also want to pay tribute to someone who's not here and just little things that people do. But I want you to know that if it were not for Bob Nash, I would be half the time a nervous wreck. He gets me to Mumia's, he gets me wherever I need to go. Quickly, efficiently. This time he took me and Murray up to Mumia today because there were too many things I had to do. I often usually drive myself, but I didn't. And he's invaluable.
Yes, he's invaluable.
He does it with love, with caution, with a spirit that is really amazing. And he's one of our unacknowledged heroes, and I want to make sure the next time you see Bob Nash, tell him you heard about him and you heard what he does. And finally, she'll be playing a role in the program, but I think a lot of people, people especially who came into the movement later, don't know who Esperanza Martel has been in relation to Mumia and I can't begin to say all the amazing things she's done in this movement. From raising money in unparalleled amounts, people don't know because she doesn't have a lot of money. You don't associate Espy with money. But Espy raises, she's a great fundraiser. She's raised money for Mumia, and she spoke out for MOVE in 1985. When the bombing happened and the Puerto Rican National Congress was meeting in Philadelphia, she denounced them for meeting in Philadelphia. That's a Puerto Rican group. She tried to get them to not have the conference there. So SB, again, is another visionary who back then and has never stopped. Whenever I need anything, SB's there. And SB has dealt, if I had to list all the things she's done, we'd be here a long, long time. So I really want to thank you publicly for the great role you've played over many, 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 many years.
We love you,
SB. We love you. So that's it for acknowledgments now. Welcome to everybody else. If I've forgotten some people, I should honor. And the Free Mumia Coalition, which is people here have done, I know who I forgot to mention. In the Mumia Coalition, Devlin and Alma, who are doing the food in the back, and do it so often. And they're both in the Mumia Coalition. And Henry, who is at the sign-up sheet in the front, who is also in the Mumia Coalition, and is always, they always participate and, you know, are stalwart supporters.
And Betsy,
who's the co-chair right now of the Free Mumia Coalition.
Betsy, stand up! Betsy, that's right, so you can know it when you see it.
So, and everybody else, please. The other people from Philadelphia I want to acknowledge is Brother Razakhan and Brother Rahim. Thank you so much for always being here, driving on short notice. And these sisters that they drive around don't stop. So they're busy. So thank you very much for coming, driving, and always being here and supportive. Okay, so we're gonna start with Murray. And I'm gonna be, if you need something repeated, she will repeat it. She speaks English perfectly, but sometimes people have trouble understanding French accents, and we really want you. You know, the French don't speak English like we do. I don't understand what's going on.
It's xenophobic.
And of course, we speak French perfectly, all of us. So, in order to make it a little more facile, a little more easy to absorb, I'm going to be interviewing Murray and asking a few questions. And later on, everybody will have a chance to ask a few more questions. So, Murray, and I just want to say that this work is not only important because, for many, many important things about it, but we know, people here have heard me say this for years, we know that international perspective is essential in order to win anything against U.S. imperialism. It's essential. Malcolm said it. The people who said we charged genocide back in the 40s, brought it to the petition to the United Nations, said it. We know what Cuba has been an example of. We know why the potential defeat of a Venezuela revolution, even temporarily, would be such a defeat for all of us. Because what does Venezuela meant? The same thing. So all of this is the context in which the international work that's done, I always pay strong attention to. And the United Nations, I do have to say that we can't just say the United Nations is not the same in all periods. So the United Nations that Malcolm was talking about was during a period of heightened national liberation struggles around the world. There were revolutions all around the world. The United Nations was being kept to a certain accountability. The United Nations today is a different body. It's controlled by the United States. It's dominated by a South Korean right-wing guy who goes along with the United States. So we have to take that into account. This isn't the same as Malcolm's period. It's not the same. But we take advantage of anything, of everything. And so this task force of people, of experts on the issue of people of African descent has put out a report that we should all be using and that is very powerful. And you're going to get a copy of it. People are going to want to see copies of it. So, Murray, maybe you could say a little bit first, in 5 minutes or less, or 10 minutes at most. The key finding, well, maybe you could say first how it was convened, how the body was convened. Say a minute, word about that, and then I'll ask you the questions about the findings. Okay. And set up, how was it organized?
Well, first of all, good evening to everybody. I'm very pleased to see some of us I know, others I don't know.
Louder, it has to be louder.
Is it working or not?
It's good.
Is it working? Yes.
Okay, now it's good.
Do you hear me? It's okay? No?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, again, I am pleased to see some of us I know. It's always good to see people. And I am very happy also to have the opportunity today to meet Mumia with our little girl, because we took a picture, three of us, and Suzanne was just between us. She's very short.
But with Mumia, see me.
With Mumia, we succeed to have a kid with blonde hair. It is a big revolution. Okay, anyway, it was a great moment, and we spoke about the working group. In fact, it's not task force, it's a working group. The exact title is Working Group of Experts on People of African Descent. It's a UN mechanism raised after a Durban 2001 conference. It was a decision taken by state. And we have a mandate for study the situation of African descent everywhere in the world who they are, to make proposal to the state to change the situation of African descent, and to write report, to make proposal, and to also meet civil society. It was a decision taken after Durban, and the group working group was created in 2003. But there is some problem. If I begin by negative aspect, the negative aspect, if the state agree for have such group, now after that they don't agree to the work done by the working group. They consider the work not good because we are not following what they want exactly. And but as experts, we are independent experts. It means we can say what we want, how we want, not how exactly, of course, not confrontally or in shouting, but we can say absolutely what we want. And they have to accept that. And for them, it's very difficult. And I have some disagreement with Suzanne. I think even in the 1960, during the liberation movement, the UN was, since the beginning, the US is problematic. Because it was created when a lot of people were still under colonization. And the relation of power was not balanced after the liberation movement. And then those who conduct the world are the same than before. And there is a very good quotation from Frantz Fanon about Lumumba's death in sociology of African Revolution, I think. And he said, we don't need the UN. The UN is doing the work for dominance, and they are just interested by their own interest. And it's absolutely true. And he said, Lumumba, when he called the UN to help him, it was a mistake.
Yeah.
And he recalled exactly what he tried to avoid. It's really a problem, and now it's the worst because we are under globalization and uniformization of thought and everything, and it's worse. Therefore, our working group is not very welcome. But we succeed, and it is a problem. If we are silent, they are very happy. They will help us fund with very little amount of money, but they will fund. If we try to to do the work properly as expert, they regret their decision, and they try to limit our funds, and they are contesting everything we are saying. No, no, blah blah blah, etc., etc. You know how it works. But we succeed to get something. One thing very important, I think, it was, if I go back, the issue of racial racism is based, we have to go back to the history, is based on a pseudo concept of race as mean to categorize and classify a person for have a better society. And saying that, they did not question the use of the pseudo concept of race. And as as long as
that's okay, he speaks French.
No, it's okay. As long as we use this term in normative law or international law at the UN level, there is something also wrong, in contradiction. Because you cannot say everybody is equal if in the meantime you have some persons they are less equal than others. Because the implementation of race has very bad consequences on the society, for the society, for the white dominant modern society, there was two kind of persons: being white, with occidental behavior and occidental thinking, and there is another one, non-being, invisible, and treated as a subhuman. Dehumanized, and what it was done with the enslavement is still there. The ideology of the enslavement is still there in the mind of the people. Even if it's not expressed directly, but in the mind of the people, in their behavior, and the decision taken by our government in France or here against the non-being are the rest of the coloniality of power, and the way also they make narrative on the history of enslavement is very interesting. They try to clean all the aspect of the truth, of the reality, what was exactly the enslavement, how it was practiced, what were the rules, and it's very, very clean. And as long as they do that, we could not change the situation of non-being, even if there is some of non-being becoming being by money, as a new bourgeoisie, as a black new bourgeoisie. It does not change the situation of all the people. And it's very interesting to see how they try to resist to that. And because they know, if they question really, if they are serious and if they accept to question the basis of the paradigm of domination, they are obliged to think about to balance the domination power. And they are not ready to do that, and particularly with African states. They are absolutely not ready to do that, because they know what they will lose. They know exactly what they will lose. That's why I am one, that's true, I am one at the UN speaking on that. And every time I put that on the table, and I have no information, no statement done without that, because for me it is its essence of the problem. And we, if we don't solve this essence of the problem, we will never succeed.
Right.
We will never succeed because we have faced the same behavior, the same intellectual, the same political, the same cultural, the same economical behavior. And they don't want to change this behavior. That's why the states, of course, are not very happy with that. Even African states, and it is very interesting to see African states against that. And some of them, but now there is, and one of the best examples I can do, and I will stop because I'm sure Suzanne is...
No, it's good. No, it's good.
We succeed two things. Because if you see, when the people speak about racial racism, they say just racism. And racism became just a generic term to speak of all forms of racism.
Yeah.
Mm. And there is no special word assuming the specific racism face people African descent or Africans. There is no one word. And when you say that at the UN, they say, but in racism there is racial. And you could say, no, there is no racial, as at the beginning should be, but it's not clear. But now, absolutely not, because when you say all forms of racism, you enumerate anti-Semitism, Judeophobia, Islamophobia, homophobia, transgenderphobia, and blah, 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 and blah, blah, blah. But what for African descent and Africans? What is the world? Where is the world?
Mm-hmm. And even if I can interrupt for a
minute, we were talking with Mumia about this today.
No, because it's me.
Okay, go ahead. Go ahead.
It's my turn.
Go ahead.
And with the civil society, with the European civil society, because there is also like Black Lives Matters in Europe, young people. I'm very upset with their situation because they cannot break the ceiling glass.
Mm-hmm.
And they are upset with that, and enough is enough. And they said, but we are faced Afrophobia.
Mm-hmm.
Afrophobia or certain other use negrophobia.
Mm-hmm.
But at the end, we said, okay, we took Afrophobia.
Mm.
And in every our report, we note now Afrophobia. Mm. And when it went once, the states were afraid. What does it mean? Where does it come from? It's new world. The UN, because when at the UN, if you use a new world, it has been accepted by the elite, by the functionary of the UN, and they don't know anything about the problem we are face, not only as African descent or African, but also as whatever the cause is. They don't know anything. They are just paid by the UN. It's totally different meaning. And we push on this world, and at the end, I was very surprised last year, last September, at the UN here in New York. I was invited to take the floor about the decade, and the High Commissioner sent a message. It was videotape, and he used the word Afrophobia. Now we said there is a word, and we will use this word. The second thing is, I don't know if you remember, but in 2011, it was decided a year for people of African descent. But nobody knows about that, and It was not existing in the public area, and the state did not do anything as usual. And we push as a working group. We push on the idea to have an international decade for people of African descent and Africans. And after a lot of work, we succeed. And it was adopted in December 2014, and it begins the 1st January 2015 till 31 December 2024. And the theme of the decade are recognition, justice and development. And you have an official website, you can, the Decade for African Descent, you can look the website and you will see what it is. But we have a big problem with the state, because first of all, our decision was to, the first theme was reparation. And reparation for us includes reparation and reparatory justice, of course. And at this moment, it was a big, 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 tsunami. It was like a tsunami. Because they consider reparation, the word reparation, impossible. And again, it was very, very, I was very surprised to listen to the African state say no way with reparation. And we discussed with them and we said, okay, we don't want to see the decade cancelled because of the world. Therefore, we try to find a world. And behind this world, as a recognition, it's impossible to have recognition without recognition of enslavement and of the need of reparation. That's why we said recognition and basta. And they say, okay, very well, we are very happy with that, And, but of course, it was, even the functionary of the UN told us, no, no, don't mention reparation, don't work on reparation issue. And as a certain of you could know me, when somebody told me that, I used to make absolutely the contrary. And last, because I think it is also very, very important. And last April, during our public session, I took the floor because I was chair at this moment. Not now, but at this moment I was chair. And that in every of my presentation, I put the word reparation. And I was really surprised to see the state for the first time say anything, not controversial, not opposed to this word. That's why now the file is open. And even we mentioned the CARICOM decision to sue French and some European states, and there are 10 action plans for reparation, and now it's okay. But the problem of the, I just want to let you know, my mandate is ending next September, and I am in charge, we are five person, one for Asia, one Philippine, one for Europe, East Europe is Polish, one for Africa is from Swaziland living in South Africa, and one for Latin America and Caribbean. And he's from Jamaica, but living in New York. And I am in charge of the Occidental country. It means Israel, Japan, Australia, West Europe, Canada, and North America. We have some problem with nomination.
The Jamaican brother is responsible for the United States?
No.
Who's
me, Vietnam?
Oh, you include the United States.
Occidental country. Okay. And the problem is the experts are elected or nominated by the state. And what we could see now, they have decided to name people, certainly very professional in their work, but knowing absolutely nothing on the issue of African descent. And it is the case for three of them. And it is very difficult to work in a such situation. And I just alert you, I am leaving next September, but I think from next July, there will be an announcement about for someone who won't apply to be expert on African descent. You have to have some, you have to know very well the UN, to be lawyer is better, jurist is better, it is my case. And, but take in your mind, as, if you know some young people, not too young, because I found an Afro-descent, it was terrible for me, because I found an Afro-descent young woman, 25, lawyer, and from Romania, for East Europe. And she was on the short list, but at the end they preferred took the Polish, knowing nothing about African descent and African, and it is desperating because very rarely he's very good guy. There is no problem of that, but for the issue of African descent, it's very important to have people who are not only concerned, it's not because you are from African descent, but also you know the situation. Mm-hmm. You know exactly what does it mean to be discriminated, what does it mean to be racialized. And when you don't know exactly, you have just an intellectual position, or sometimes even not intellectual, you are just watching, okay, you know. And it's a huge matter of concern. Okay. First round.
So, a few questions. We need to have the sound off for a minute. He has to. They have to do testing of the sound. So I'll stand up and speak loudly for a minute, and then we'll turn it on again. When we were talking with Mumia today about the way the concept of race is watered down to mean nothing and to definitely dissociate it from people of African descent. Mumia and I were talking about how it became so ridiculous that reverse racism became a concept in this country, you know, that was used totally to undermine the serious dealing with racism. So I just wanted to remind us of how ridiculous that struggle has been. The other thing I wanted to share is, and we haven't really said very much about Mumia, that we spent time with Mumia today, and I'd like to say at least a word or two later on about how we found Mumia. But he spoke very highly of a new book by Mark Lamont Hill called Nothing or No One, something like The Denial of Reality of People of African Descent. He said the book is powerful, powerful, powerful. So I wanted to share that so people know. So the report, first of all, some of the stories Murray has shared about the difficulties of working with this task force, who these five people were. You know, you think five people from the whole world, you'd surely find a really radical perspective of an African. The representative from Africa, who people thought was from South Africa, was from Swaziland. Swaziland is a monarchy that has been right-wing forever and ever, and that's who was representing on this body. So, you know, the obstacles in terms of doing serious work were phenomenal, really phenomenal. But to my surprise, and one of the reasons I wanted Mireille to come, was I read the report she sent me on the United States, and it's mind-blowing. Mm. I thought, how did they know all this about the United States, to the point of focusing not only on healthcare, and there was an interesting statistic that one of the things about Obamacare was that it really did bring insurance to a large number of black people.
Yes, it did.
That was not there before. Mm-hmm. You know, and I've been so native, I hadn't even known that.
Right.
So that was interesting. And the other thing, I worked in the schools for years, I've been an educator for years,
And I remember when the police was brought into the New York school, public school system, because I had just begun working actively on Mumia. So it was around 1990, the discussion was going on around the mid-90s, and I think it was 1996 when they brought in the police into the schools. And it immediately put an atmosphere of, created an atmosphere of terror in the schools. I remember I was working at a school on East 33rd Street, and they said, the cops, oh no, 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 they're not gonna do anything but be there to back up security. Within a minute, they're asking kids for their IDs as they go into the cafeteria. That wasn't supposed to be their job. The police took over. The police took over. And you've seen, heard the stories of little girls being arrested, thrown across, all over this country. Well, this report refers to that, documents. And they did work in Chicago. So, you know, the world is too big. I propose that we, I really told Annette Murray that I'm going to ask questions specifically about the U.S. report, because that's really of relevance to all of us, as not to mention, not to to diminish the importance of the international, but we deal with this every day. So I wondered if you'd say a couple of things. I just pointed out the two things in the report that stood out to me, that they went down to the detail of the police in the schools and Obamacare and its impact on black people. So Murray, could you please summarize as best you can, what you say the salient, the outstanding points about your working group's observations on the race issue and the denial of rights to people of African descent in the United States, and then I want to go to your recommendations, because you had recommendations. So if you could summarize your observations. Is that too much? Too big a topic?
No, because it's not great.
Oh, you didn't get a chance to read. She's sleepless too. All right. You don't have to do it all. You don't have to summarize it all. The points you remember and you okay, that you think were important, and then we'll talk about recommendations.
First of all, we went in a 5-city: Chicago, Jackson, Mississippi, New York, Washington, Baltimore. And it was very difficult to go there, because there was, in fact, I suggest to the working group to make some follow-up, because the first visit was in 2010. But after that, we normally in the report, we have a part of what is good done by the country. What we observe, the difficulties, and then recommendation. And regarding the recommendation, we don't know exactly if it apply, implemented, or not. And if it's not, why? That's why they suggest to the working group after 5 years to go back to the country and to see what is done or not. And this country visit was the second. And the country visit is not our own decision. We have to be invited officially by the government. And they invite us. As you mentioned Palestine, I will just say, as I know very well the situation in Palestine and Israel, I suggest to the working group to go there and to have a country visit in Israel, as there is a lot of problem also as a xenophobic, but also racial racism in Israel, even against their own Israeli citizen. And we succeed to meet the ambassador. He was very happy, blah, 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 and he said, okay, you will receive the date soon, and 1 month, 3 months, 4 months, 5 years, 1 year. And we were waiting, what happened, nothing. And when we sent letter to ask him what happened, well, no, did you renounce or not, tell us, no. He never answered, and in fact, it was for them the way to use the UN system to say, you see, we agree to welcome official country visit, but we don't know why it was not done. And it is a way for them to use, but also to excuse themselves of what they are doing against Palestinian, but also against their own population. In the US, what shocked me the most of was the situation in Jackson, Mississippi.
Yeah.
And I did not realize, I know pretty well the situation, but I could not imagine the situation was so difficult and even so close from the segregation times.
Mm-hmm.
And I was absolutely shocked by that.
Mm-hmm.
It was also something very difficult, not difficult to understand because all states are like that, but it was also the lack of knowledge, of recognition, of the exact recognition of the situation of people of African descent in the US by the State Department and by the different person we met. And I remember only one lawyer in Baltimore agreed to say the justice is unfair and the carceral system, the mass incarceration is it's a shame and there is a racial justice. It was only one, and we met a lot of jurists and person working at the justice ministry. Also, I was very surprised by the determination of African people we met, and the necessity for them to use this report. That's why we, in fact, what you read, all of you, is just a pre-report.
Mm-hmm.
At the end of the mission, we issue something like a press release as a pre-report. And then the report will be, the final report will be issued 26 September. And it will be presented in Geneva on the 26th and at the General Assembly in November, next November. And I encourage you to go and to try to take the floor to make some comments if you can. We could not, from abroad, we could not imagine the exact situation. And it's unimaginable, ununderstandable to see such situation and as a such level. It makes me very pessimistic. It's now in France, for example, or in more or less in Europe, we are taking the same way.
Yeah.
And the victim of racial racism used to pay the high price for the incompetency of the state decisioner. And they are absolutely forget, exclude, marginalize. And we could speak about segregation. That's why it's very important, I think, the Black Lives Matter movement is so important, because it's done by young people, and they have a new form of activism, and I think it's very important also to renew our form of involvement and activism, and they are not ready to accept what we have accepted. And for that, I encourage them, but also I encourage us to follow them and to support them very strongly.
Yeah.
Because if something could change, it will come from them.
Mm.
Because we know we are all have a white earth, even if some of us make some color. And we have a long experience of fight against racism, and we did not succeed to tackle it, as the UN did not succeed also to tackle it. And I think we, what?
Jackson? No, I just want to jump in.
And I was also very impressed by the situation we saw in school. We were not allowed to see a prison, to visit a prison. Normally we have. But they suggest to us to go in a very, I don't remember the name, but I think it is in the final report because I pushed to mention that. It was a very, they want to send us in a very, very modern prison. Mm-hmm. And I want, because I know the situation, in Parchman, Mississippi.
Wow.
And they did not allow us, but anyway, we know the situation.
And it was a prison?
Hmm?
I think it was a juvenile detention center, wasn't it?
No,
a prison.
Parchman, it was a prison.
It was a prison, okay.
And also, one of the concerns as a jurist is the complexity of the judicial system. Mm-hmm. The law edicted by state, the law edicted by the federal, and the law edicted sometimes by county.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And there is a compatibility between them, mm-hmm. and it's a force at the end, of course, the victim of the criminal, the so-called criminal, is sentenced, but very highly. Mm-hmm. And also the fact, and it is a huge question, because the U.S. did not ratify the commission,
human rights,
Inter-American Court, the Convention of the Inter-American Court of Human Rights, right. And normally, and also they did not ratify the Commission of Human Rights, the UN Commission for Human Rights, and normally when the people, human rights. UN Commission for Human Rights.
And what about the child? Wasn't there one about children too that they didn't?
It's something different. I don't know. And but what it is very normally when a people is sentenced and he see his or her fundamental right violated, mm-hmm. he have some possibility when he use all the level of different jurisdiction in his or her country. And his right is not respected, and he considers he has to get more justice, a fair trial. He can go further at another level, and for you it is the Inter-American Court. For us it is the European Court of Justice or the of Human Rights first. And for Africa, there is the same thing, African Court of Human Rights. And for US citizens, it is impossible, as they did not ratify the Inter-American Court of Human Rights. That's why there is something from the structural adjustment in US with
biased.
Biased, mm-hmm. with bias, and for the victim of unfair trial, it is absolutely impossible to get a clear and respectful answer regarding his case.
Yeah.
And that is one of the concerns. And they try to tell us, no, it's not like that. We, and also there is some, because some of cases are sent to the are sent to the Inter-American Court, but the Commission, Inter-American Commission, would choose which case will be sent to the Inter-American Court. And if you see, I watch, and really I watch, I make a research on, there is no one case coming from African descent.
Wow.
And there is only one case for indigenous people.
Wow.
That's, it's a long you see, we could see, if you regard exactly what happened, you could see how the system is built. And it's built since the beginning of, it is absolutely normal to violate the fundamental rights of African descent. Mm-hmm.
Great. You know, there's much more that, thank you, Pam, there's much, much more that Murray could talk about. And just the little sense I had of it today was a lot of fascinating aspects. I was hoping we'd have more time to talk about the I was hoping we'd have more time to talk about the recommendations, but one of them that I noticed was that the United States sign these treaties that it has refused to sign.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And make itself accountable to international law. So that's pretty basic. If they didn't even sign these treaties, and one of them has been the rights of the child. Mm-hmm. And you know, for all kinds of reasons, whether it's conceding to Saudi Arabia or to child labor issues, the reactionary concepts behind this, there's a tremendous depth to the level of depravity of this country on the issue of human rights that you see in this report. So I strongly recommend you read it. Murray will tell us later on how you can read it. And also, hopefully we'll have some time for questions. In the meantime, rather than wait, because time flies, let us welcome our great warrior sister, Pam Africa.
You won't sit down.
Oh, the address. Somebody asked where the check can be sent.
P.O. Box 19709.
Brother, who asked me?
19709.
Philadelphia. 19143. Ooh, I just want to say thank you. And we was dealing with a bit of an emergency. Sister Basima Muhammad and my sister Laura Razakhan's sister I'd seen me jumping up, running around. The cops had kicked the door in and broke her windows and things. So that's what we were dealing with, you know, now. But the movement is so great that people got there. I don't know what the details is, but I know the cops is going, the sister's in the house, and we'll find out what's going on, you know, what happened there. But this is just a magnificent movement. And, you know, I just want to talk about, real before I go into Mumia, the magnificence of this movement. And, you know, because we tend to don't really deal with that particular part. And I'm not going to go all the way back. I'll go to when Mumia was told that when they had sentenced, when the ruling came down from the Attorney General or her desires to stop Mumia from being able to broadcast, write books, and anyone who attempted to help him and or will be charged criminally, they can be sued and things. During this time that this was happening, we're in court in Pittsburgh, and a federal court, right, was federal court. And, you know, the people around the world jumped into this. And it wasn't behind the goodness of the judge's heart that made them, you know, deal with the issue properly and stop the Attorney General from, you know, carrying this out. Because they would have made criminals of all of us, because I know we all would have been breaking the law, because how do they think that we're going to stop speaking about Mumia and then see, in order to do it with Mumia, it had to go all the way across the board. And also, it would have been with anybody. And, you know, H-Rap Brown, Brother Jamil Alameen, Leonard Peltier, and, you know, any of the political prisoners, the Move 9, any of us. And our brother, Major Tillery. People going to have to help me out because I'm hyped and my mind is over there and here. And but before I go there, bring me right back to there. And because I just need to thank people, because every time this government think that we're not moving, and you know, because we move quite differently from how this government is used to seeing people move. And every time they think that they have us backed up. And see, one thing, we got these motherfuckers pent up against a wall. All you gotta do is convince everyone else, you know, of the mightiness of this movement. Like I said, we won that in federal court. Then Mumia wound up sick in the hospital. And when they moved Mumia to the hospital, as we won a victory, and that they couldn't carry out with the attorney general, to silence Mumia. And we find out that Mumia's in the hospital. Sister Johanna and someone else, Heidi Bogosha, had went to visit Mumia to get some papers signed. And someone inside there told her, see, people, you know, is everywhere. That's why they try to make their machines everywhere, right? Someone who had some humanity in them told Johanna where Mumia was at. We were in Pittsburgh. We was able to get there in about half an hour, 45 minutes, and stop the murder of Mumia. That's right. What I know. We stopped that murder. They had him in the emergency section. We were able to get in to the hospital. Mumia was in the room here, and we was on the other side of the wall. Right. And I'm saying we were not small in number, but we knew how to act and understand what was going on in that other side. Our brothers and lives was on there. We managed to get full media out there, and I'm saying everything was happening like this. Bang, bang, bang. And these people was just, they couldn't believe it. We couldn't believe it, and all because it was just happening that way. But see, Don Africa told us all these things was going to happen. But you know, right after that, we managed to get Mumia. Everybody know all the turmoil that, you know, they put Mumia through. But it's this movement. It's this movement. This mighty movement. This week, last week, and all for the 4th of July, no, the Labor Day weekend. And the judge comes down, Marani, with a decision that stated that Mumia lawyers, and you know, in the 1981 trial, and when Mumia's lawyer made an error in getting a witness to come, Judge Sable said, your lawyers goofed. And you know, which was a lie, they didn't goof. And you know, they blocked them from getting the information out. The push it back up to last week, Judge Marani said that the protocol that they have for Mumia and for 6,000 other you know, inmates in the state of Pennsylvania and 46,000, well, the inmates in Pennsylvania, that the protocol was horrible. He said it was unconstitutional. Anytime a person, before they get the, and I'm saying it was the movement again. How we found out about it? It was the pressure that was put down on this government. When they took and put Mumia in Scranton, Pennsylvania, in a racist town, and they thought the people wasn't coming. But people came from New York, they came from Washington, they came from Chicago, people came from Baltimore, people came from all over. 3 days we sat in that courtroom. 3 days the lies that unfold, the conspiracy to kill Mumia unfolded. And there was a hepatitis C committee that we knew nothing about at all, and was formed in court, or you know, right during that time. And the judge said in his statement that, you know, the hepatitis C was unconstitutional, and that, you know, all prisoners should be getting hepatitis C because it's a problem when, you know, your esophagus, the veins in your throat have got to be bleeding. You got to be damn near dead in order for them to give you the cure. It's... In order for them to give Mumia the cure, it's $1,000 a day. Yes. They paid $140,000 for a week in the prison. But they would not give him the cure, which would have been between $86,000 and $90,000. And these people are hell-bent on killing Mumia.
Yes,
but you know, we keep pinning them and exposing them. Yeah. The only way anyone knew about the protocol, because state representatives, when they tell you to vote and vote, and that's right, sis, that was that one right there. And it was the people and who was in the courtroom with the judge and the lawyers who forced the protocol out. And when the protocol came out, the judge was shocked. Could not believe it. And how can anybody, hook up a protocol that says you gotta be dying, you gotta be bleeding out of your throat, and your liver has got a cirrhosis of the liver, has gotta be all through you. You gotta be damn near dead, and then if you're not dead enough, then we'll give it to you. But if you're just a little over damn near dead, you're not gonna get it, because what's the use? And I have statistics and numbers and stuff, but the hell with all that right now, because the issue is the murder of not only Mumia, but the murder of 6,000 people, the conspiracy to murder. Not that, I think it might happen, no. And it is our job to get out and let everybody, because it's happening in New York, and New York has begun to help people out. California has begun to help people out. But a beginning is better than nothing, but we gotta continue to push. Pennsylvania, out of the 6,000 inmates, 5 get hepatitis C medicine. 5, and you know what's happened with the 5? They damn near dead. They cure the hepatitis C, just like in our brother Seth Hayes, and our political prisoner upstate New York, and they cured the hepatitis C, but the effects that was done to his body, is irreplaceable. He is suffering, right now. Mumia looks beautiful. When they went to see him, when I went to see him, remember how messed up his skin was? His skin looks beautiful. When he talks, when he writes you, but Mumia is a man who is a walking person that's dying every day. And are dying every day. We must get like we were when they signed the death warrant on Mumia. You couldn't move for people in the streets, meetings here, meetings there, meetings here. But Mumia, who continues to write about everything, Mumia makes me so damn mad sometimes, because he don't talk about Mumia. He's talking about everything else, saving everyone else's lives. And the only reason why you got Mumia saying something about what's going on right now with him, because it's detrimental to 6,000 other men, women, and children inside the prison. Us, the power of us, this is what we gotta understand. When them motherfuckers came on the Thursday before Labor Day weekend, came with the decision, they was looking for us to be not ready. Not ready. And because people was on vacation, you couldn't get hold of this one, that one, and the other. But the strength of us is not in what you see and hear. The strength in us is much stronger. And the New York Coalition represents how many? The government says millions around the world support Mumia.
Right.
And you're not going to always see them. So look, what happened just before then, Murray was due to come here. There was already a thing in place for Murray to come here, which Suzanne was pulling together. The New York Coalition had worked with us to do, and the campaign to bring Mumia home. Let me tell you, we don't always see each other. We don't always see each other. Rachel Wolkenstein wrote a piece that is true. We have the guidelines to get Mumia out of jail. We got them. Everybody was saying a while ago, well, wait a minute. What is next in the courts for Mumia? We had to come up with something. Bang. That something came to us. in a form of, and Rachel's going to talk about this, I'm just talking about the different things that went in place all of a sudden. Rachel was already dealing with Cash Steel. The New York Coalition, the campaign to bring Mumia home, all of us was dealing with when that decision came down and what we was going to do. And we had planned and we had talked about a day when the decision come down, what we going to do. We never got a chance to do it. We were all busy taking care of mothers, fathers, sisters, brothers, you know, running here, running there, doing this, doing that, dealing with our own health and stuff. It wasn't done. But when that damn decision came down, all we had to do was make a few phone calls. A few phone calls. She went into effect. Johanna, she pulled together, and everybody should get this packet of information and the press packet. This press packet is so damn tight, and it got everything in it. All the statistics you need about Mumia and the hepatitis C, you know, all the criminal acts that have taken place to prove the conspiracy, the information that will prove, and what went down with Ron Castile, and you know, everything is in here. And we called for a day of rage. We did that when we first started off. And you know, Betsy, who put it together, and Sophia, who threw it out on the air, that everybody in here who heard it and passed the word down, everybody couldn't make it to Philadelphia. Everybody didn't make it to Philadelphia. But if I stood there by myself in Philadelphia, that would represent millions around the world. If it was 10 of us, it represents millions, because we're pulling and we're pulling and we're pulling. And those who could not make it for whatever reason and was doing what they could do where they were at. When we got to the hepatitis C building, and not the hepatitis C building, the health department. And on the day of rage, we picked three places. And we did it, you know, on Wednesday we did it. And because the weekend you couldn't get in contact with people, so we did our phone calling. And we did that Monday was the holiday. Tuesday we give people time to get back into their offices and stuff, look at their mail, and they say, oh shit, let me start, you know, they started dialing, started doing everything that they could to do. People was calling, I can't be there, but I'm going to make some phone calls, I'm going to do this. So when we get to the hepatitis C building, I keep saying the hepatitis C building, because that's what I associated with, the health departments. When we got there, and you know, it might have been, what, 20 of us?
Yeah.
20 strong. Yeah. 20 strong. Yes. 20 strong. Strong. Any strong. And we acted like we were 20 million in the streets that day. Because when you have the power of truth, can't nobody stop you. I'm going to tell them. I'm going to tell them. Be cool. Be cool.
I'm so excited.
Yeah, it was exciting.
So we were in the streets.
And because the reason why we went to the health department, because I found out that they were dealing with hepatitis C, but they wasn't dealing with the prison. So we had to get there, become comrades with them. Well, we did find out that although they deal with hepatitis C, when we was talking about demonstrating against the people who charges $1,000 a pill, right, they said, oh, we can't do that. We said, why? And they said, because they're the ones who pay us. Right. I'm like, okay. See, in strategic revolution, there's a place for everybody. You're talking about the dangers of hepatitis C, and you're talking about it for everybody, but you're not saying prison. We'll say that part. Right. We had them demonstrate at the governor's office with us, and last month before last, and you know, they've been there. They do their part. I got their little books over here telling people about hepatitis C, and now, you know, when the time came to deal with Mumia, they wrote us a letter of support and how they're getting other people involved in it. And they understand the meaning. They're still not telling you to go up against the people to pay their paycheck, but that's us. That's us. You just do what you do and let us do what we do. So we work good together. You call on people like that. Then, you know, we don't always work together. But when that need comes, I'm telling you, we come together like this and we form a strong fist and we gut punch them motherfuckers right on back to where they came from. They are gut punched and to the point that they're reporting now. They reported Channel 3 was there, Channel 10 was there, and old Mr. Trump. And they had a thing for him down the street, but they got out of town before we got, got finished our thing. We go and we demonstrated there, and we're pointing out very clearly, we are not demonstrating against the health department. We're here to talk about the work that we do together and how we can work together. If people have an inkling that they have it, go ahead and get it checked out, right? So, you know, we kept that bond going in there. Then we go to make our little march down to the governor's office, because as we speak now, people, Bible, he's in France, and Johanna organized that. And I'm saying, things be happening at the point that the French asked us to come over there to the big festival that they had, the right. And then they was organizing a meeting with the European Parliament to sit down and talk about Mumia and what's going on with Mumia. It's not the first time, but it's the first time I couldn't go, Mona couldn't go, Johanna couldn't go, Suzanne couldn't go. So Johanna worked tirelessly, got Bob Bull to go, she got Robert Maripool to go, and the young brother from Black Lives Matter went, and they called us up and they was telling us how magnificent they were, and you're different places that they're on their way to now. So I'm saying, it's just blasting and blasting and blasting that energy, that they're feeling over there, and we're feeling it here. And then, tonight, it just goes on and on. But you know what we really need to talk about? Because what we got to continue to do is put pressure and educate people on where things is at right now. And let people understand the power that we possess. Ain't no power like the power of the people, and the power of the people won't stop. Yes, ain't no power like the power of the people, and the power of the people don't stop. Say what?
Ain't no power like the power of the people, and the power of the people don't stop.
That's right. So anyway, here we are, and are still organized. December the 9th is coming.
Yes.
This is the day that they chose to kill Mumia and failed. So they beat him, they stumped him, they rammed his head in the pole, split it wide open, shot him in all his chest to this day. It split, is scarred up. That's when they gave him hepatitis C. And so I'm saying all these things come back. And here we are, December 9th is coming up, and they're still trying to kill Mumia. What I'm saying is we got to do, and Rachel is saying what you got to do, and a lot of us say we got to shut that motherfucker down. Shut it down. And they got to know we're coming. They got to know that we are coming. We ain't sneaking. Our meetings we personally had it in front of the governor's office.
That's right.
Letting him know for years. Diplomats from around the world have come here to speak with these people. The only person who's ever been able to speak to them was Madame Danielle Mitterrand, who was the first lady, who was the wife of President Francois Mitterrand, who did away with the death penalty. And not only she came here and she to Philadelphia, she spoke to the mayor and told him, first she went to visit Mumia. Then she went to visit then Mayor Ed Rendell, who later became governor. Now he's some other kind of big wheel up there. She told me, she said, I could have came here and visited your president. He was offering her to see the Liberty Bell. She said, I'm not interested in your Liberty Bell. Don't ring for us. And she was pointing out that Mumia is innocent. And I'm saying, these are the people, the Japanese diet. It go to Congress in France, and the black elected officials in Pennsylvania and got scared now. You don't hear them, because those people who on the front line, talking about David Richardson, he was on the front line for Mumia. He didn't back down, he didn't
part the way or anything.
That's
he
right.
was straight up. That's why they took him out.
That's right.
And they took a lot of other people out who had these strange heart attacks. This, that, and the other. But you know, we just kept coming and coming and coming because there ain't no one leader here.
Yeah,
it ain't no one leader here. We are all leaders in this fight for Mumia's life. Every last one of us. John Africa taught move people that, you know, that you see, John Africa was a leader for move. He taught move people how to be leaders. When you move, if I'm not here, my Pixie, my Rose, my baby down here can become us.
Yeah.
You know,
come
and
to
I said
for.
That's what's been
come
happening
to
through
that's
this
right.
movement. And all you know, because we are not without. We have everything we need to take this down. We have everything we need to bring this brother out. All we gotta do is convince those, not convince them, show them. Show them through strength. I'm saying what people see in me, what they see in Ramona, and all the people be clapping about is the fact of the consistency.
Yes.
The consistency. We know that if we show up, and if like it was 20 of us, we was 20,000 strong. We took the center of the damn
that's
street
the
and marched on down
over
to the governor's office.
The middle
office.
Of the street.
Shut down.
The middle of the street.
20 people.
With 20
right.
people. It was
that's
amazing.
Right.
It was amazing.
20 people. And you know, the cops thought that they could like, little monkeys. No, oh God, poor monkey, I'm so sorry. Cops on bicycles and all, you know, want to flex their little nothings and want to start some shit. I hadn't said one curse word. And because I'm building my thing over, you know, with the Board of Health, right? So yeah, so we go to get our thing together to go to march. And one of them talking about, oh, fuck Mumia.
Oh,
and all, you know. And then, you know, another one talking about, that's, you know, the sound of electric, you know.
Right.
Talking about, he should have been dead. I said, what the fuck you say? You know, and then the other cops who know, and you know, for those who didn't know, it became right there, Broad and Lombard, a whole FU demonstration. Because explain to them who the hell you are.
Fuck the police.
You know? We're here out there saving your damn life.
That's right.
You know, because you ain't got guts enough to stand the fuck up here and deal with these goddamn people like we are.
That's right.
I'm saying your mother, your sister, your brother have hepatitis C and you don't fucking know it. But you want to deal with us? You want to say, you know, because it wasn't for Mumia, we wouldn't be there. You wouldn't be educated about what's going on.
Sure.
So we went on that realm. And I tell you one thing, they shut up. They never said another word through that whole entire administration. And you expose them and let them know who they are, what you're protecting. And the people that's trying to kill you. You ain't doing nothing about your water, your air, your soul. You're upholding these people. And also, anyway, we wind up going to the governor's office. From there, oh my God, this little lady here. And I thought Suzanne, and for people who don't know Suzanne, who think that she's this little lady that don't curse, little blonde hair, professor, doctor, whatever you want to call her. And the cops got some other words for her. And she went to tell them about, you know, setting up the meetings with the French, and the French supposed to be coming. Last year when we tried to hook it up, they said we didn't. We should have gave them two weeks or more. She gave them a month and a half.
Wow.
They was writing us letters like, you know, oh, well, the governor won't be in Philly at the time that you want. So she wrote them another letter telling them, you know, well, we'll be wherever he's at.
Yeah.
And you give us the meeting, that's where we'll be, whether it be in Washington, Pittsburgh, Mars, we'll come, you know. But at the last minute, they turned around and said they wasn't giving us a meeting.
Uh-huh.
That's why we was there,
mm-hmm.
to expose him, not only for what he was doing to Mumia, what he's doing to 6,000 other people, but the 46,000 unsuspected people that are going inside the hotel that once hosted Legionnaire's disease.
Oh.
How many people going there know that that's where they was at? And you got the governor in there stopping them. The information and making them aware, because people with money, there's money in there, making them aware. You better go put some of that money on some Havani, you know? That's the name of it, right?
Right.
But anyway, we went there, then we went to the district attorney's office. That's where it was Rachel's turn to deal with what it is that she had to deal with. And she dealt with
Ron Castile, and she will explain that to you, who Ron Castile is. And you know, and I just want to thank you all too, because we do need the money, because we got to be here, there, and everywhere. We don't have monies, and you know, but we moving around, and because in order to have to shut Philadelphia down, we're going to have to be somewhere everywhere, and we need people's help. That's what I'm saying. These packets are so important because they give you statistics, and it tell you about the criminality that was going on in the courtroom, how the doctors and all was manipulating papers, how it was exposed in the courtroom that, you know, a doctor who said that, you know, Mumia should be getting the medicine, and how the DOC switched the papers around and said, you know, that, you know, he didn't need the medicine, and all the exact words is in here. And if they don't have enough of these papers for you tonight, and there will be packets for you tonight, IAC, they did. They produced the packets, and where Betsy at? Betsy came here and put them together.
Prudence.
Well, the two of them, they worked and they did this. Johanna put it together, and I'm saying none of us was in the same room when we was doing things. When Rachel wrote what she wrote, and when Suzanne did what she did, what Johanna did, because she was busy just getting back to school, dealing with a father that's sick. Mm-hmm. Rachel dealing with, you know, your husband was sick, you just lost your mother, and you know, Suzanne just coming back off a vacation. A much needed vacation. And jump right into it and was dealing with, you know, personal issues. All of us, we do our personal stuff, but it does not stop us from doing what is necessary. And we show up when we show up. And on December the 9th, and I want people to understand, it's not just December the 9th. December the 9th is like something that we use to get people to get out into the streets. You got to be visible, and you know, get out into the streets and let people know what is going on, you know, and we educate. We're not just educating them about a day. We're not just educating people about Mumia. Yeah. We're educating people about what is happening to us.
That's right.
We had to battle inside the prison about water.
Yes.
We found out where my brother Mike was in prison at. That, and you know, you wouldn't have to tap me, and you know, for real. We found out at Greater Spring, and the guards are told you cannot come in here unless you bring your water in. Any new guard come in, they got to sign papers knowing that they got to bring their own water in, because the water was too dangerous for them to drink. And the same thing was going on in the surrounding outside, but people were able to get it. But the inmates couldn't get the water. And they were bonded from the lifers inside the prison. But how many brothers inside the prison have no money to buy water? You know? And not only if you can't drink it, these pores, you putting that water on. When you flush that toilet, that water's going there. When you wash your hands, you wash it. When you gargle, you brush your teeth, you brushing it with that poison. Every day. Every day. And they wanted us to keep quiet about it. And we raised hell, but we were raising that hell by our damn selves out there. And to the point that, you know, we still, I'm saying at this point, anything we do is justified. This Thursday, City Council, I'm not going in there, because we've been there. Talk with them. They were supposed to put the issue of the hepatitis C on the floor. They messed around, and didn't do it. And I'm saying, we planted that seed while we doing other things. Now it's time to come back to it and demand. I ain't going in there asking for a damn thing. I'm demanding, taking the floor. And because Janie Blackwell, Cindy Bass, you name names, how come you didn't do what you were supposed to do? I'm fighting for my brother and each and every last one of these people that sit inside here that can write you know, I answer to what is going on. Raise the question in your community. What the hell is good is a city council person, a state representative, if you ain't informing people about the dangers of what's going on? They run around here with this Hillary Trump mania bullshit and choose one, the lesser of the two evils. Evil is goddamn evil. Tell me to choose one or the other. You know, we come in here to educate, to accept, so the people can stop accepting the bullshit. I'm going to sit down now because I'm fired up and I know I can fire y'all up. And but again, the information package is thorough. They're complete.
They're online.
They're on the website. Johanna, they're on the website, right? Everything. And also, you know, the 3 days, 3 days in Scranton, you have got to read it. It's like a, it's like it should be a damn bestseller. And I mean, it's thrilling. And Mumia, and for the first time since 1995, 96, was in the courtroom for himself. But he was by video. But he was there. I'm saying we break rules and things, but they're not going to tell you about it. You found out about it in Workers' World. Yes, you did. It's in the paper there. You'll find out about it, you know, all over, you know, the independent media. And, you know, look, people, thank you. I mean, got high up in here, you know. But,
how many people showed up at the DA's office by the end of the day?
Oh, shoot. By that time, I'm in the car sick. And, you know, for real, I got, my head was splitting. But it was people of all colors, and the UNIA was there, the fourth assistant general to the UNIA, Sister Basima Muhammad, and the second one. And you had the nation there, you had IAC there, you had the New York Coalition, you had a lot of people there, and but it totaled up to be 100. And that 100 act like they were 100,000. The cops did shit that they had never did before, but it always helped us. They stole her pocketbook, and she blamed it on them. But they, the sidewalks, they covered the sidewalks with their bikes, which put us out in the street. Good. We blocked traffic,
That's right.
One thing for sure, we didn't give a damn how they tried to cover that office up. We was going to be there and we was going to put information out. And that brings people from the outside and who never heard, don't know what's going on, to get involved and start telling the stories of what is happening to them, what's happening to their loved ones on the outside, and the stories of the babies who have hepatitis C. And you know, whose livers was messed up, who they had to, where they tell you, you know, well, get a transplant for a baby, get some damn hepatitis C cure, and cure their parents, and you know, and y'all know what I'm talking about, right?
Yes.
And look, thank y'all for the support, and Mumia and the inmates around the world, and depends upon each and every last person, you know, in here. And thank you. All power to the people.
All power to the people.
So again, I want to remind everybody that Rachel was one of Mumia's attorneys back in the 90s with Leonard Wineglass, that Rachel has never stopped doing work for Mumia to this day, is always pushing a particular line and a particular point of view. And we really welcome here tonight to educate the rest of us what she knows in great depth. Please, Rachel.
Okay, thank you. Yeah. Thank you very much. I can't really follow Pam, but I'm really happy to follow Pam here because I want to start by saying nothing is going to happen legally for Mumia unless there is a mass international movement. You hear? Okay, fine. All right, I can stand up. I just want to make the point, which has been said, I want to underscore it. No matter how much good law we have, no matter what the lawyers are like, no matter anything, nothing will happen for Mumia in the courts unless there is a mass international movement.
Right.
Okay. You got that? Mass international movement is essential. Without that, nothing else is going to matter.
That's right.
Okay. The reason why this particular moment is so significant with the legal possibilities is because the way the world works, generally speaking, people, to get out there, they actually help when they feel that there's a shot. And a shot is going to be in the courts. The last time I knew or heard in American history that people got somebody out of prison, bust them out without suffering the consequences, because people have been busted out with the consequences, was actually, no, there were consequences. There were consequences. I'm talking about without those consequences, was in the before, right before the Civil War. When fugitive slaves were bussed out of jails in Boston, because there was enough of a social movement, because they were at the beginning of a civil war, to be able to get them out, and nobody did a damn thing except let those men out. Okay, so until we're at that point, and I hope I live to see that point, and we all live to see that point, we're going to need a legal hook. Yes. And also that legal hook, I want to use those terms, are what actually helps people mobilize and get out on the streets and all that. Now, a lot of us here were out there for Mumia after he was already convicted and before there was a death warrant and before there were things going on in the courtroom. Okay, a lot of us were there and we fought and we built things so that when in fact that warrant happened and those courts happened, there were literally millions of people around the world. So I'm not saying it's not possible, but now we are at year 35. And we went through the PCRA hearings from 95 through 98, went through the decision in the Supreme Court of Pennsylvania, the federal court things, all sorts of evidence, all sorts of things, the millions for Mumia March, you know, marches all around the world. So now we're at year 35. And what has been important to say again is that the state has tried to kill Mumia forever. Yep. Since he was 14, 15, 16 years of age, they tried to kill him. They didn't succeed then in framing him up when he was a Black Panther Party member. They tried to kill him on the streets on December 9th. It took me a lot of years to understand what it meant when the slogan for Mumia's trial and everything was, his only crime was he survived.
Right. That's right.
I just want to say that.
Oh, absolutely.
I'm going to interrupt Rachel for a minute because Mireille has not had much sleep for days. She's come across countries and continents, and she really has to go home and get to sleep because she's going to Washington tomorrow morning.
That's
so
right.
Please, let's say thank you, Mireille.
Experts on African descent.
Okay, and if it doesn't work, we will contact Mireille. Okay?
You type after, you see that on the right, there is a country visit report. And you type, you click on, and you will get
okay.
it.
Okay.
I think on the 26th or 27th, it will be on.
Thank you very much. Okay.
Thank you very much.
We'll link it from the freemumia.com website.
Take a picture of it. We have a Mumia. I don't want that out.
We'll link a report from the freemumia.com website.
Okay, if I can continue.
Could we go on, please? Could you give Rachel your attention? Folks, if you want to talk to Mireille, please go down on the elevator with her. Do not speak back there. Folks in the back, please. Let's show respect for Rachel. Okay.
Mostly I'm going to run out of time, and I was only given 10 minutes to begin with.
Start now.
Okay, whatever. And even, my point, look at where they've been trying to kill Mumia forever, and now he has been sentenced to life imprisonment without the possibility of parole. He is being killed with the Hep C. This is a continuation of the attempts to kill Mumia by the state and, of course, other people, other prisoners, political prisoners, everyday prisoners. You know, this is part of the brutality of U.S. capitalism. And the point is that right now we actually have another opportunity to wage an international fight for Mumia's freedom. And it is important for Mumia, the person, the man, to get out of prison with all that represents. There is no other prisoner in this country at this particular time who has engendered the type of organized animosity and fury from the FOP that Mumia Abu-Jamal has. Even though we have tons of other political prisoners, we had the Move family being bombed. But he is the only prisoner who is that type of orchestrated thing nationally that's going on. And that means something. That means that this state has been organized and views him as not just the voice of the voiceless, but as the symbol and the sign of black revolt in this country. And that's what I believe Mumia represents, and he has spoken out on behalf of everybody, every oppressed person, every black person, every poor person in this country and internationally. And having Mumia, a win for Mumia, a win is a win for us. Getting Mumia out is a victory for us that can only help the social movements, the struggles and everything, not to mention free this man who should be free and should have never been arrested, never been attempted to be killed. Whose only crime that night is he survived. So that's my beginning, okay, of what I think this is about and why when this decision happened it provided a huge opportunity, and his lawyers, Judith Ritter, filed a lawsuit which comes within the purview of this. So what is this all about? Every once in a while you get something in the U.S. Supreme Court through a mixture of different things which actually works for us. Okay, yes. Every once in a while, and you need to use it for their own reasons and whatever. And part of what happened is they got fed up with actually the Pennsylvania Supreme Court and Justice Castile and the death penalty and all those things. That's the only explanation politically for it, because they didn't do it because they're adhering to the law. Justice Castile refused to recuse himself, in other words, remove himself from the review of Terry Williams' death sentence. Mm-hmm. Terry Williams was the football player that people may remember. There were like gazillion million things on the internet and everything demanding he not be executed. They came up with the stuff of being sexually abused as a youngster and all that. Well, Terry Williams won in the lower court, in the Pennsylvania first level court, like think of Judge Sabo. Only this judge voted for Terry Williams and said there had been prosecutorial misconduct and said that this case needs a new trial. That was taken on appeal to the Pennsylvania Supreme Court, where Castile has been a justice since 1998. I believe, or before. I can't believe I never remember this right now. I'll give it to you in a second. Okay. Since 1998. And what he did in that, he was asked to recuse himself because he had been the district attorney. Castile followed Ed Rendell. After Ed Rendell left, and Ed Rendell was the DA when Mumia was charged and was convicted, came Castile. And Castile was the DA, we'll come back to this again, for Mumia's appeals. But he was also the DA when Butter, his name, Terry Williams, was actually charged. And he signed off as the DA, the DA has to do, if you're going to seek in the DA's office the death sentence as opposed to life imprisonment for somebody who's accused of murder. That is what Castile did as the DA in Terry Williams' case. He also did it for 45 other men who are still incarcerated in Pennsylvania right now, 45 people. He personally sought the death sentence for. So when this case, he refused to recuse himself, went up to the U.S. Supreme Court after denials and various things in the courts, and the U.S. Supreme Court said, basically, their own version of enough is enough. Because justices are allowed, just understand this, justices all the time sit on cases that people ask them to get off. for conflict of interest, for individual bias, for something to do with it. And they say no, and they give you the finger, and guess what? They're allowed to do that by and large, because it's up to the great ethical standards of U.S. judges to be able to make those decisions for themselves. That is what the basic law is in this country. So what the U.S. Supreme Court did in this case is they said, no, if a judge had been a prosecutor in a case where they had a direct personal involvement in that case on a critical decision in the prosecution, they cannot sit as a justice in that case, whether they're the only justice or they're part of a panel. And the reason why I emphasize these points is they're saying it's not enough, like Justice Casile was, to have been elected with the money from the FOP. It's not enough for him to have been supported by the FOP and getting honors from them. It's not enough for him to have publicly spoken proudly of having gotten these 45 death warrants and all these other people that were convicted. It's not enough that he supported all the prosecutors who actually were criticizing appeals courts for prosecutor misconduct. That's not enough. That's just the everyday stuff. What's not the everyday stuff, the U.S. Supreme Court said, is when you do this personal thing. And even in that, the way the Philadelphia DA's office argued this case, it didn't matter that Castile signed off on the death warrant because that was just a ministerial act. It was no biggie. You know what I mean? It was just like you check the box. And you know what? The prosecutor looks for the death sentence and they get the death sentence, no biggie. And the U.S. Supreme Court said, you know what? We think signing off on a death warrant, or not death warrant, but to prosecute and get the death sentence for somebody actually is a significant thing. And we think that's a significant element, and therefore Castile had this personal direct involvement. That's the standard. It's called an objective standard. This is precedent setting in the United States. This has not existed before this case.
This is great, Rachel.
Huh?
This is great.
Okay, well, it's great in the abstract. Now, Mumia's case is not everybody's case, as we all know. Mumia has not had the benefit of court precedent, and the entire rounds of the every element of this state, capitalist state, both parties, Democrats, Republicans, have geared themselves with the FOP up to keep Mumia, try to kill him, and then to keep him in prison locked up. And it was very clear when they decided not to seek a new death sentence for Mumia back in the end of 2010, that was a political decision.
Yes.
Because not a legal decision, because his death sentence had been overturned in 2001.
Right. Mm-hmm.
The judge had said in 2001 it was an illegal death sentence. For those next 10 years, he sat in solitary confinement, still on death row with all those restrictions, facing the possibility of a reinstitution of his death sentence. It was a political decision.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And it was brokered, in my very strong opinion, by Ed Rendell, along with the FOP, and Maureen Faulkner, and a lot of other people, too, who I'm not going to name right now, because it wouldn't be politic for me to do that. So that's what happened. And it's because they were afraid of what would happen if they ever brought Mumia back into a courtroom again in Philadelphia.
That's right.
Because they kept him out after 97. He never was brought in for any hearing after we finished with the Sabo hearings. And the reason why everyone walked in the middle of the street last Wednesday is because they were afraid.
That's right.
That's what it's about,
that's
afraid.
Right.
When the cops move away from you like that, there is such a level of fear that they're not even going to do their normal thing. And that's been in my experience in other situations as well. Okay, so the point is, so what is it about Mumia's case that brings him within this and means that we really have, on a legal front, a real possible legal win?
Yeah.
It is this. Castile was an assistant district attorney, a senior one, during Mumia's trial. We don't know anything more about that, okay? But he was there, and he was senior. Then he became elected the district attorney.
Right.
And as the district attorney, he oversaw all the appeals.
That's right. Mm-hmm.
That is his job. And Mumia's case was not just any case. And even though Mumia did not challenge any of the evidence in his case for other reasons, he challenged a variety of things, beginning with the question of jury selection, that black people were kept off of his jury. That was his issue that he argued himself personally in the very beginning of his trial, that he argued through his appeal, and he argued all the way straight up to the Supreme Court in the Third Circuit, that had always been his issue. Now, what was the first thing, the two first things I'm going to tell you that Castile did when he became elected the district attorney? One was, something that we haven't ever made a big deal about, is he appointed somebody head of his legal appeals division. And that is a guy by the name of Ron, I'm blanking out. I'm not going to go through that right now. It's in my thing here now. He has been the charge of the Appeals Bureau, and his name has been on every Mumia paper from the DA's office since the 1986 when Castile became the DA and appointed him that. Before that, he was not that. But more significant, that just shows me, you know, Castile's responsibility in it. But in terms of the specific act, at the point in which Mumia was arguing in the Pennsylvania Supreme Court, and his case did not get to the Pennsylvania Supreme Court for argument until 88. Mm-hmm. Okay, a long time after he was convicted in 82. That's another story, not going there right now. Was that the other thing Castile did is he put together a DATV production video. That stands for District Attorney TV Production. On the question of jury selection, which we all called, including myself as part of the legal team primarily, the McMahon tape. Right, right. Because that was the DA whose name was on it, who did all those vicious things explaining how to keep black people out and how to hide it so nobody found it out. And this was in response to a Supreme Court decision in 85 called Batson, in which it said, Supreme Court said, you cannot keep black people out of the jury. You cannot even use your automatic, you know, getting rid of jurors that prosecutors can do if you are getting rid of black people, and that's what you're doing. That is the first thing that Castile did, is he made that tape.
Yeah.
And actually, McMahon and the DA's office covered for Castile because it kept on being called the McMahon tape. And the official position from the DA's office was the only person who was responsible for that tape, which says DATV Productions on it, with cameras and everything, was District Attorney Ronald D. Castile, and called DATV tape. Okay? So that, as far as I'm concerned, in addition to 100 other things in his case, that, I mean, I don't have time to go through, I think is the key thing that is the direct action. Now, there is motions for discovery of other things, and I'm sure we'll find other evidence, but that's the direct thing. And it's an issue which goes to the core of racism in this country. It goes to the core of class bias in this country. It goes to the core, one of the many cores, of how there is no real justice in the U.S. justice system. So that is the hook. And that is part of the issue here. And to let you know is that in 96, when I was part of the legal team, and we had finished the first hearing, the only first, we had wound up having three evidentiary hearings, but we finished the first one, and we were on our way going to appeal, we made a motion for Justice Castile to recuse himself. We did do that, and we argued all these things about evidence and evidence of prosecutorial misconduct and evidence of Mumia's innocence and how Castile was supported by the FOP and he supported all his prosecutorial misconduct prosecutors and all that, and we asked for recusal. The justices did not decide anything until they totally shut down every single one of Mumia's appeals in 98, just in a vicious, horrible decision. And Castile basically gave everyone the finger. Now in 2002, when Mumia had another set of lawyers, Marlene Kamish and Elliot Grossman, and they presented the evidence of Arnold Beverly, but they also did things like fight about the jury selection. And they demanded that Castile answer questions about what relationship he had with this DATV thing, and they totally ignored it. So we have direct actions of actually trying to get Castile to recuse himself that he didn't do, and we have the direct things he did. So that makes a powerful, powerful legal case, and I'll just finish up because my time is out basically, is this, is that what do you get if you win on this issue? What you win is a do-over of all of Mumia's appeals. Every single appeal from 1998. It means that all get wiped out. Not the original one, but everything afterwards, which all covers the original ones. And what happens if you have, now this is my jump in legal, from legal lease to world reality. If we have enough social weight, enough demonstrations, enough everything to actually convince the courts that they better grant this for Mumia, then it's all open. I mean, at a minimum, he gets to redo all his appeals. But in reality, to redo all that, then it's a question of, is there going to be a new trial? Is there going to be a new trial? Is there going to be a dismissal of the charge? But it depends. I know this sounds like pie in the sky. I almost felt that way when I was writing it myself. But it's a reality. It's a potential reality.
It's possible.
It's possible. It is a potential if there is the political movement and motion, which is why I heartily endorse that we all have to organize as and in the process of doing it for December 9th. And actually put huge resources in it because it's really our whole fight.
Thank you. Ashe! Before it ends, wait, everybody, before it ends, I neglected before to thank the International Action Center, the Solidarity Center, which hosts us, Sharon in the back, Marsha, and